Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda this morning, customarily, is to agree to take item four on our agenda in private. Are members content? We are. The second item this morning then is to move to continuation of our consideration of petitions that we have been considering previously, the first of which is petition 1919, which is to ban the sale of high caffeine products to children for performance enhancement, lodged by Ted Gourley, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ban the sale of fast-release gum to under-18s for performance enhancement due to the risk of serious harm. And we last considered this petition on the 20th of September 23, and at that point we agreed to write to the Scottish Government. We've received a response confirming that the independent analysis of its consultation on ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people has been published, and that the responses to that consultation did not raise any issues associated with fast-release caffeine gum, although obviously the consultation wasn't focused specifically in that area. The response also confirms that the Scottish Government will not be pursuing research on fast-release products at this time, essentially for financial reasons, but will keep this under review for future years. Now, we've also received two written submissions from the petitioner suggesting that labelling for high-strength caffeine gum should include a health warning about potential risks, particularly when using it immediately before or during intense physical exercise. The petitioner also believes that the promotion of caffeine gum at public events may be in breach of health and safety regulations. It may be worth noting that regulation of workplace health and safety is reserved, and that much of the health and safety legislation derives from the Health and Safety at Work Act of 1974, which is actually primarily focused on the safety of employees in a workplace. So, I think, colleagues, we were quite struck by the evidence when we heard it last September that there was something of a risk here. The government hasn't really sought to validate that and doesn't feel at the moment it's in a position to do so. I'm sort of reluctant just to close the petition at this stage because I'm not yet satisfied myself that there isn't an issue, but I don't know yet if there is an issue of major concern. So I don't know if we have any suggestions as to what we might do. I'm minded potentially just to ask the clerks to give this some thought and maybe to come back to us with some suggestions of where we might yet go. I'm not sure how far we can go, but I think we could maybe just find a little bit more, because I wouldn't want this to become a more obvious health problem and for us just to have moved on quite so quickly. The second of our petitions is petition 1962 to stop motorhomes parking overnight out with formal campsites, caravan parks and areas. And the petition was lodged by Lynn and Darren Redfern, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve the licensing enforcement on motorhomes to ensure they are only parking in designated and regulated locations. The Scottish Government's recent submission states that work is still underway in the campervan and motorhome working group and that no formal report has been submitted to the Visitor Management Steering Group. It was agreed that a formal report would be provided at the end of last year. I understand that that group did meet and that that information is now on the Scottish Government website, at least the formal location of it. The petitioner has shared information about the prevalence of motorhomes parked out with a campsite or areas and the associated issues, and this includes figures on roadside waste disposal, scorch marks and litter. The petitioner believes that if the tourist levy is applied to campsites but not to motorhomes on roadsides, that the number of people opting to stay out with formal sites will increase significantly. And the submission also highlights the positive economic impact of the holiday park and campsite sector. And of course, here we are in May 2024, going into the summer season, when I imagine these issues will be at their most prevalent. So I wonder if colleagues have any suggestions. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I think I would like to raise two further issues which I don't think the Scottish Government has satisfactorily answered throughout the history of this petition, and I don't want to refer to any particular business in the Highlands, but want to raise two points of principle. First of all, that I think, excuse me, early on in the petition convener, in the passage of the petition through this committee, I had suggested that funding might be made available to things called AIRES, A-I-R-E-S, which are a kind of serviced area which can then be used for the parking of camper vans. And these are frequently found in France, for example, and they are designed to provide a safe, secure place with water and toilet placement facilities, which are obviously needed, and to stop the antisocial behaviour which results from camper vans parking illegally overnight in lay-bys and so on, and blocking single-track roads. Now, the reason I mention this is that the Scottish Government reply was, yes, we are looking into this, and we think that AIRES should qualify for funding under the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund. And that was positive. And it was agreed, I think, that they should indeed qualify. But just about at the time when this was agreed, the fund ran out of money. And we learn from Clarks, I think, that the figure, the reduction in the capital budget of Visit Scotland from which the fund derived last year was 7.9 million to 2.6 million, which, if those figures are correct, then I think the Tourism Alliance have said that this is a fairly swingeing cut, given that the overall capital budget was depleted by, I think, about 8 or 10 or 12%. So this seems to, the tourism budget, this particular budget seems to have been absolutely axed in a very savage manner. And the sad thing is that I had just learned, and I've sent a copy of the letter to the clerks, just in case it's required for the record, in a separate letter that I'd written to Malcolm Roughhead of Visit Scotland about Loch Ness, South Loch Ness maintenance trail, to see if there was any funding for that, which is a constituency matter raised with me, that Malcolm has said that no less than 20 million has been provided through the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, which has allowed many good things to be done. But sadly, it's now difficult. So I do think that we should ask the Scottish Government, I'm sorry this is taking so long, but just to set out the detail of it, that, you know, would they, in reflection and with the new regime, reflect that a reduction of 67% is just absurd? And if so, will they look at adjusting that? And the second point is that, and incidentally, I think AIRES should be run commercially. I think the government's role is to provide the servicing, the plot, but then operate it commercially so as you're not providing an unfair subsidy against existing camping and caravan sites. The second point I wanted to raise was really regarding directly the overnight stops of camper vans, and I understand that this will not be covered in the visitor levy, but camping sites will, and fixed caravans will. Now, this does seem to me to be anomalous, and it's almost an incentive not to have a fixed site, but to have a camper van and move around. And I must say, I'm not a wild fan of the visitor levy anyway, but it seems to me that this is going to create an obvious anomaly, which will cause a great deal of upset, especially in the Highlands, and particularly amongst people that run camping and caravan sites. Because, you know, when I was tourism minister, I went round a great many of these and developed a great admiration for the professionalism, the hard work, the diligence, and the high standards of cleanliness and safety that were practiced in almost all of these sites. So for them to be kind of discriminated against in this way, seems to me to be prima facie unfair, and I wondered if the committee, if committee members agree that this is a fair point, given that the visitor levy bill is at stage two, could we raise this with the Scottish Government to ask if they have any intention to do this? Because if they don't, it will come back and bite them, as so many things do in ill-considered legislation.
Our colleague's quite happy to do so. I think I am, and I think also, I mean, you mentioned, would they potentially consider afresh the 67% reduction? I think we might ask them also what they think the consequences of not doing so might be on the industry and communities as a result.
Yeah, it was a huge benefit for the Highlands in particular, actually. And so I have that particular interest, I guess. But it did benefit a huge number of projects all over Scotland. And it was also regarded by most of my colleagues at the time as a very popular and successful and simple fund to operate relative to many others.
Okay, we will do that. So we'll keep the petition open and we will seek to pursue the issues as identified by Mr. Ewing. Our next petition is petition number 1964 to create an independent review of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman lodged by Accountability Scotland, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an independent review of the SPSO in order to investigate complaints made against the SPSO, assess the quality of its work and decisions, and establish whether the current legislation governing the SPSO is fit for purpose. Now, we've considered this petition before. Colleagues may remember the submissions. The petitioner has brought to our attention that the Ombudsman stated her support for a review of the legislation governing the SPSO. The Ombudsman stated this view during the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee's scrutiny of the SPO's annual report. Her view is that the current legislation is not as adaptable as it should be for the different ways of delivering services and making complaints. And it's worth noting that while the Ombudsman has stated her support for a review of the legislation, the petitioner is also calling for an investigation into complaints made against the SPSO and an assessment of the quality of its work. So from different starting positions, the Ombudsman and the petitioner seeking this review. We are aware, and it's important to note, that the SPSO's functions are independent of the corporate body who met with the Ombudsman recently, ministers and MSPs, to ensure that there is no interference in the decisions that are made. However, I mean, we're in the slightly unusual position that there has never been a review of the Ombudsman. I think in previous evidence there was an expectation that a review would at some point take place in the way that the arrangements were structured. The government seems reluctant to undertake the review that the petitioner would like, but the Ombudsman herself is actually quite open to the idea that a review should take place. So I wonder on the basis of that if Mr. Torrance has got a burning suggestion for us as a result. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would agree, in the light of the Ombudsman's submission, to write to the Scottish Government to ask whether, in light of Ombudsman's comments, it will consider undertaking a review of the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman Act 2022.
Are we content to go back to Mr. Ewing?
Yeah, just to add to that suggestion, with which I agree, any review must be an independent review. It cannot be done by the SPSO, nor should it be done by the Scottish Government. I think it should be done by somebody entirely independent. And I do respect, Convener, particularly since we're supposed to be in a time of fiscal difficulty and pressure, ask the question of whether the public actually get any gain from having an SPSO. And it's no imputation on the professionalism of the SPSO, but it's restricted in its powers and remedies, so that actually I no longer recommend to any constituents that they go to the SPSO, because A, they're not going to get anywhere, B, they don't get a result, and C, very often they end up even more fed up than they started off in the first place, because they feel the whole process is frankly pointless. Now, it sounds harsh words, but you know, should we really be looking to see if we can prune back some of the public money and put it into the health service, for example?
I wonder then if we might also draw this petition to the Finance and Constitution Committee, who are currently undertaking a formal inquiry into office holders, with a view to looking at the whole sweep of the office holding positions. I know that the corporate body is due to give evidence to that committee, and I've previously, on behalf of the corporate body, raised issues of concern that the corporate body have had when I've been presenting the Parliament's budget to the Finance and Constitution Committee. So I think it might be useful for them to be aware that, you know, that this petition exists and that the Ombudsman herself is actually keen on a review, which the government doesn't seem very minded to pursue. We're content with all that? We are. The next petition is petition number 1975 to reform the law relating to strategic lawsuits against public participation, which we've heard much about recently. The SLAPs, as they are known, lodged by Roger Mullen, urging the Scottish Government to review and amend the law to prevent the use of strategic lawsuits against public participation. And members will recall that we took evidence from this petition from the Minister for Victims and Community Safety, and we were encouraged in so doing by news that a consultation on SLAPs would be progressed in the autumn. And therefore, with this information in mind, and given the evidence we've heard, but given that the government are going to pursue matters, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee could write to the Minister for Victims and Community Safety to ask how the petitioners and the contributors to a petition can meaningfully engage with the consultation, and request that a committee be updated as the Scottish Government's work progresses. I wonder, in doing so, I don't know if we could take a petition any further after that, so I wonder if the committee would consider to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government is progressing the issue raised in the petition.
I'm quite happy to write to the Government on that basis, but then thereafter to move to close the petition. Are we content to do so? And I think with some success on behalf of the petitioner, actually, on this occasion. Their end result.
I think they achieved the change in policy of the Scottish Government. Yes.
That brings us to petition number 2028 to extend the concessionary bus travel scheme to include people seeking asylum in Scotland, lodged by Pinar Aksu on behalf of the Maryhill Integration Network and Doa Abumar on behalf of the Voices Network. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend the current concessionary travel scheme to include all people seeking asylum in Scotland, regardless of age. We are joined by our MSP colleague, redeeming one of his return tickets, Paul Sweeney, who continues to have an interest in this petition and led a members' business debate on the issues it raised in October 2023. Morning to you, Paul. We previously considered this petition on the 20th September 23, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the Scottish Refugee Council and the Refugee Survival Trust. Members will recall that shortly after that meeting, I took the opportunity to highlight this petition at the Conveners Group session with the then First Minister, Humza Yousaf, with the First Minister confirming that it was an issue the Scottish Government were giving active consideration to. We've received responses from the Refugee Sanctuary Scotland, who were formerly known as the Refugee Survival Trust, Transport Scotland, and the Scottish Refugee Council, which are included on papers that we have received for today's meeting. The responses provide further detail on the pilot schemes that have taken place in Glasgow, Aberdeen and Falkirk, with the Refugee Survival Scotland findings emphasising the positive feedback they've received from participants in the pilot project. This enabled people to travel more frequently and to travel over longer distances. Now, following the pilots, the Refugee Survival Scotland has recommended that future provision for people seeking asylum be implemented through the provision of a long-term digital ticket or through extension of the National Concessionary Travel Scheme. Extending provision on a national scheme is viewed as increasingly important in the light of Home Office dispersal policy of locating asylum seekers across Scotland, while most of the support systems are based in Glasgow. Although my understanding is that the Scottish Government is keen to ensure that any action they take doesn't have a consequential impact on the asylum seekers arising from other Home Office regulations that might thereafter be triggered. But since we last considered the petition and raised the issue with the First Minister, the Scottish Government has now announced funding of £2 million to support further exploration of extending the free bus travel to people seeking asylum, with the commitment also noted as an immediate short-term action in the recently published Fair Fares Review. And before, as a committee, we consider these issues, I would ask Paul Sweeney if there's anything he would like to say to the committee.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd also just like to take the opportunity to commend the petitioners, Pinar Aksu of Maryhill Integration Network and Doa Abumar of the Voices Network, who have worked tirelessly alongside people with lived experience of the asylum system for several years now on this free bus travel campaign to extend access. Indeed, I think it's been at least 2 years this campaign has been running. I welcome the announcement from the Scottish Government last October that £2 million would be allocated in the financial year 2024-2025 budget to enable the rollout of free bus travel for people seeking asylum in Scotland. However, I join the committee today to urge caution and to encourage members to keep this petition open for the time being. Whilst the funding announcement is welcome and indeed overdue, the detail on how this is going to be utilised and what it will actually mean for people seeking asylum remains to be seen. The original ask of this petition is, of course, to extend the concessionary bus travel scheme. but there is no indication in this announcement from the Scottish Government as yet that a concessionary bus scheme extension is what these funds will actually be used for. No sign of a draft statutory instrument, no indication of the logistics and the detailed design of the scheme as yet. So there is a risk that these funds are simply used up for more information gathering and research, or a temporary scheme rather than making free bus travel a permanent reality for people seeking asylum in Scotland. Frankly, we don't need more data. We have had a pilot in Glasgow. We've had another in Aberdeen. We know there is a need and we know how to meet it at a relatively marginal extra cost to the public purse. So I would urge the committee to write to the Scottish Government and seek written confirmation of what the detailed plans are for the rollout of the scheme with this £2 million of funding, and to assess whether that funding will be used to actually deliver on the ask of this petition, which is to extend the National Concessionary Travel Scheme to people seeking asylum before the committee gives any consideration to closure of the petition.
Mr. Sweeney, do colleagues have any comments? I think it would be perfectly in order for us to, the Scottish Government or Transport Scotland, Mr. Chowdhury.
To write to the Scottish, listening to Mr. Sweeney, I think we should write to the Transport Scotland to seek an update on the work being undertaken to explore options for extending concessionary travel, especially how the £2 million budget allocated is being used.
Yeah, Mr. Ewing.
Yeah, I'm just a bit puzzled, and maybe I've misunderstood something, but just looking back at the evidence that Mr. Sweeney gave to the committee previously, I think you said rough and ready estimates suggest it would cost around £500,000 per annum. Well, £2 million is enough to fund the whole caboodle for 4 years. So what's happening to this £2 million? I mean, what's the point of saying here's £2 million if it's only going to cost £500,000 a year? I mean, why don't they just do it? I mean, I don't quite understand. I mean, if that money is, just to finish the point, if that money is set aside, it can't be used for anything else. It's just allocated from the budget when the cost, it seems sufficient to run the thing for 4 years. What's going on?
Well, I think the First Minister and the then Cabinet Secretary said that, first of all, there are issues in identifying who an asylum seeker is, because actually they're not, it's not like being a pensioner who's self-defined, and it's not like being under 21, which is self-defined. How do you define an asylum seeker? And I think the second issue is they are concerned that the scheme would have to operate in such a way is it didn't then contravene the Home Office guidelines as to what constitutes, is it earnings or benefits? I don't think asylum seekers are entitled to receive benefits or something, so it could potentially alter their status. So I think there's been, my understanding was there was some detail to be worked out as to how it would come about, but I think after 6 months, it's perfectly in order for us now to try and establish, as Mr. Sweeney suggests, what on earth is going on, because we're well into the financial year and the scheme itself is not actually helping anyone to travel anywhere. So I do think there is then the contingent risk, as Mr. Sweeney says, that the money ends up being used to finance a whole lot of research being carried out rather than putting people onto buses. Which is what the intention is.
Put it away in consultants' reports. Yeah. I mean, that would be farcical and rather grotesque, actually.
So, we've got the nominal success, but I think we want the substantive success to follow on. So we agreed to keep the petition open and to make the inquiries as suggested by Mr. Chowdhury?
Yes.
We are. Thank you very much. That brings us to petition number 2030, to review cultural funding arrangements to enable Scotland to contribute to the Venice Biennial in 2024, lodged by Denise Hooper, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to renew the funding it provides to Scotland plus Venice, and to ensure that Scottish artists can contribute to the Venice Biennial in 2024. And we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 20th of September 23, when we agreed to write the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland, largely because I think the material responses that we'd received didn't really explain anything to us at all. Am I missing something? I'm pleased to say that we have received responses from both the Government and Creative Scotland, and they confirm that the Scotland Plus Venice project was paused in order to carry out a review into the relevance and impact of the project. The response from Creative Scotland notes that the review will present and evaluate options for change, underpinned by a clear financing strategy, and is expected to support future planning of Scotland's participation at the Venice Biennale from 2026. I might suggest that Creative Scotland investigate some of their other funding at the same time, but that's a separate matter. In response to the information provided by the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland, the petitioner has expressed concern that it may therefore be 2027 before Scotland is represented at the Venice Biennale again. The petitioner also highlights comments from the then First Minister, Humza Yousaf, that investment in Scotland's arts and culture will be more than doubled over the next 5 years, which the petitioner believes should allow greater flexibility for Scotland's participation. The committee has also received two submissions from the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, updating us at various stages on the progress to develop and publish the International Culture Strategy. That strategy was published in March 28, 24, and subsequently debated in the Chamber. So I wonder, in the light of the explanation we've received, such as it is, and the resolve and determination that there appears to be, that there won't be any participation in 2024, nor 2025, it would seem, if colleagues have any suggestions for action. Mr. Chowdhury.
Did we get any update from the Creative Scotland review?
Well, we did. I think that's what I just to the matters to which I just referred. I think they explained the basis of the pause that they had implemented.
They haven't come to any conclusion.
Which was due to conclude this month. So the review that they're undertaking into the value of Scotland's participation is due to conclude. But that was why they had paused our participation. I think there was a previous evaluation at an earlier date which didn't actually lead to a pause in our participation the last time round, but it has this time. That was their explanation. But
I was thinking that if we keep it open until the conclude the review, and if Convener wants organise a visit to Venice for the committee. Well, I think we should, I feel that we should wait until Creative Scotland review is concluded.
Well, are you wanting me to formally record that as the recommendation, Mr. Chowdhury, or is the committee visit to Venice part of your consideration as well?
Both of them.
Yeah, both of them. Fine. Yes, well, I think in the first instance, we might keep the petition open, as Mr. Chowdhury suggests, and ask Creative Scotland, if the review is concluding, if we could get some update on what the conclusions of that review have been. I think that would be a reasonable... And what the consequences of conclusions they've reached are in terms of Scotland's future participation in 2025, 2026 and 2027.
I'd love to go to Venice, but I don't think I would be asking the taxpayer to fork out for that, just for the avoidance of any doubt.
Yes, well, I've been on a number of occasions, but under my own steam, I have to say, but not for the Arts and Culture Festival. In all seriousness, I think the volume of visitors I read just recently to Venice now is almost intolerable in terms of the ability of the infrastructure to cope on a daily basis. And I certainly know if you're staying in Venice, you really have to be up at 5 o'clock to have a wander around in the morning. Otherwise, you can't move. It is definitely under a lot of pressure. But nonetheless, it has a series of quite famous and celebrated arts festivals through the year. And Scotland's participation in these is to be valued. That was the last of our continued petitions. It brings us to the consideration of new petitions. As always, before we begin the consideration of any new petition, can I say that to those people who might be tuning into our proceedings because we are about to consider one of their petitions, that as a matter of course, in the first instance, we contact the Parliament's independent research body SPICE, and we also seek the preliminary views of the Scottish Government. And we do that because historically those were the first two things the committee agreed to do, and it simply avoids us building further delay into our informed consideration of the petition. So the first of those new petitions is petition number 2079, which is to introduce legislation to provide for exemptions in paying medical facility parking charges and to create a new classification of parking badge for caregivers. This has been lodged by Martin James Keating, calling on the Parliament to urge the Government to bring forward primary legislation to provide for exemptions in paying medical facility parking charges and to create new classification of parking badge for caregivers. The SPICE briefing provides information on existing eligibility criteria for the Blue Badge scheme, noting that it applies primarily to on-street parking. In responding to the petition, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care notes the decision to abolish car parking charges at all NHS-owned car parks. It is also noted that responsibility for parking policy beyond NHS facilities rests with local authorities, and it is up to them to decide how much they should charge for parking and if any exemptions should apply. These were changes now of some long-standing practice. The Cabinet Secretary also recognises the huge contribution made by carers and through implementation of the National Carer Strategy aims to drive forward long-term changes to improve the lives of unpaid carers. We have also received a submission from the petitioner. Responding to the Cabinet Secretary, the petitioner highlights that carers perform tasks in the absence of the disabled person they support, but in such circumstances would be unable to make use of a blue badge. The petitioner suggests that the introduction of a carer's badge scheme would be a tangible demonstration of support for the role carers play, while helping to address the financial impact parking charges have on carers, some of whom are in fact simply volunteers. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
I wonder if the committee would consider writing to Disability Equality Scotland, COSLA and Carers Scotland, seeking their views on the action called for in the petition, specifically the petitioner's proposal for introduction of a carers badge scheme. I wonder if the committee could also consider writing to Scottish Government to highlight the petitioner's submission and seek further details on what consideration the Scottish Government has given to introducing a carers badge scheme.
Again, I think perhaps highlighting that a number of these people are volunteers, and you know, this represents potentially quite a considerable additional burden. And I think that maybe distinguishes them from requests that might be made for other groups within society who might also be looking, for exemptions. Many of them are in completely different circumstances, but I think in this instance, the ask of the petition is worth pursuing. We are all agreed. That brings us to petition number 2080, to implement the recommended screening guidelines for people with the Lee-Fromeny syndrome. And it's lodged by Louise McKendrick and calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to implement screening for people with or at risk of Lee-Fromeny syndrome TP53 mutation, in line with the guidelines recommended by the UK Cancer Genetics Group. LFS, as it is known, is rare, with researchers estimating that a few thousand people in the UK have it. The UK Cancer Genetics Group guidelines recommend regular screening for people with LFS. The SPICE briefing we've received notes that the guidelines cited of petitioner do not actually recommend routine cancer screening for those identified as being at risk of having the TP53 gene mutation that causes LFS, and instead recommends that they should be offered appropriate counselling and support and encouraged to have considered whether they want to be tested for the TP53 gene variant. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that the UK Cancer Genetics Group guidelines are endorsed and supported by clinical genetics teams across Scotland. However, the Government is aware of variations in how those guidelines are implemented across health boards in Scotland and of the acute demand for MRI procedures in particular. The Government is considering how to better signpost management guidelines and improve consistency of implementation. So in view of the UK government position and the Cancer UK Genetics Group responses, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Ewing.
Well, just reading the background information On the petition, convener, the LFT 53 mutation is said to be a genetic syndrome that predisposes a person to cancer, usually of an aggressive type, and that the relevant authoritative body, the genetics group, the UKCGG, have made recommendations for screening which have been implemented in parts of England but not implemented in Scotland. And I see that there's a reasonably sympathetic reply from the Chief Operating Officer of the NHS Scotland in the written submission, which doesn't really give out much information other than to say there's sort of good intentions all round, but there's pressure on MRI scans, which is absolutely understandable. So in the light of that, you know, I certainly don't think we should close the petition. I think there's more information we need to get. I'd like to go back to the Scottish Government to ask if they can provide a bit more information about what services are available in, for example, each health board. If this group of people are predisposed to cancer and of an aggressive type, it does seem to me to be, albeit a rare disease, a very serious one, and I see there's nearly 1,000 signatures in the petition. So obviously it's attracted a considerable concern broadly. So I wonder if we could ask the Scottish Government to give that further information in the light of the gravity of the matter, and secondly, to write to Cancer Research UK to seek its views on the action called for on the petition. I do wonder if there's perhaps some other things we might do, convener, but maybe colleagues have other thoughts, because it doesn't seem to me that the response at the moment is adequate.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. Do colleagues have any other suggestions we might add to those of Mr. Ewing? Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, convener. I wonder if we could write to NHS Scotland's genetic laboratories in Aberdeen, Dundee, Edinburgh and Glasgow, seeking further detail on the work we do to support the implementation of UK cancer genetic guidelines and information on genetic testing and support available for those with at risk of having a faulty TP53 gene.
OK, so a series of suggestions as to how we might proceed. Are members content that we proceed on that basis? We are, thank you. That brings us to petition number... So we thank the petitioner for raising this fresh issue with us. Note the number of signatures the petition has attracted, and as you can see, we will seek to take the issue forward further. Our next new petition is petition number 2081, to make chronic kidney disease a key clinical priority, lodged by Professor Jeremy Hughes on behalf of Kidney Research UK in Scotland, calling on exactly what it said on the tin, urge the Scottish Government to make chronic kidney disease a key clinical priority. The SPICE briefing notes that chronic kidney disease is a term that can be used to cover a range of kidney impairments, from a small loss of kidney performance with no symptoms to a life-threatening condition that requires regular dialysis of kidney or a kidney transplant. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government state that the relevant Cabinet Secretary and Minister have previously corresponded with the petitioner to advise that the Scottish Government does not intend to increase the number of health strategies for individual conditions at this time. It is noted that the Government's approach to clinical conditions policy is something that is kept under regular review. The Government response also notes work to support people with kidney disease, including the launch of a national policy on the reimbursement of electricity costs for home dialysis for patients. We've also received a submission from the petitioner concerned that the Scottish Government's criteria for choosing what will and will not be designated a clinical priority remains unclear and poses two specific questions in relation to this petition. Why is chronic kidney disease not already a clinical priority? And why has the Scottish Government taken the decision not to increase the number of health strategies for individual conditions or to assign the status of clinical priority and the civil service support that goes with it to any additional conditions? The petitioner also highlights the potential benefits to patients and the clinical community where a condition affecting them has been designated as a clinical priority. For example, bringing clarity on who within the Scottish Government has day-to-day responsibility for developing condition-specific strategies and action plans. Do any members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Golden.
I think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care to highlight the petitioner's submission and seek information on the criteria for determining clinical priorities. Also an explanation as to why chronic kidney disease is not already designated a clinical priority, and also request further detail on the Scottish Government's decision not to increase the number of health strategies for individual conditions, including chronic kidney disease.
Yeah, I mean, those directly respond to, I thought, two perfectly legitimate questions that the petitioner has raised, which is why isn't there one already, and what exactly are the criteria that determine why there can't be any more? So are the committee agreed? We are. That brings us to the next of our new petitions, petition number 2084, allow alkaline hydrolysis. And this has been lodged by Randall Graham Kilgour Foggy. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Burial and Cremation Scotland Act 2016 to allow alkaline hydrolysis, which is the accelerated in composting and other more eco-friendly methods of disposal of human cadavers. Alkaline hydrolysis, also known as water cremation, is a method of disposal of human remains using hot water with the addition of chemicals. The current legislative framework for burial and cremation allows the regulation of any new methods of body disposal in the same way that burial and cremation is regulated. How we move from one subject to another in the Petitions Committee. The Scottish Government recently consulted on burial inspection, funeral director licensing, and it did consult on alkaline hydrolysis. The consultation sought views on proposals and regulations on all for topics under the Burial and Cremation Scotland Act 2016. The report on the alkaline hydrolysis consultation states that 84% of respondents support the introduction of regulations to allow alkaline hydrolysis, which I understand is practiced elsewhere. It concludes that the Scottish Government will now consider the proposals for regulating alkaline hydrolysis in the light of this consultation's findings, and that it will continue to engage with the funeral sector and other interested parties to further inform the development of policy proposals. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
Can I put on record, convener, a petitioner is a constituent of mine who has discussed the petition with me, so I will let my colleagues make recommendations.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Would anybody else like to come forward with proposals? Mr. Golden?
I think we should write to the Scottish Government to ask, in light of the consultation responses, whether it intends to regulate alkaline hydrolysis in its development of regulations under the Burial and Cremation Scotland Act 2016, and when it expects the outstanding regulations to be implemented.
Thank you. Are we content? Well, I'm happy to say to the petitioner that we are not going to bury the petition, but we are going to make efforts to keep it alive. And we will wait and hear what the responses to our inquiries are. Petition number 2085, to introduce a statutory definition of residency for fatal accident inquiries into the deaths of Scots when abroad. And this petition has been lodged by David Cornock. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce a statutory definition for fatal accident inquiries into deaths abroad. And we're joined this morning by our colleague Michael Mara. Welcome to you, Mr. Mara. The SPICE briefing we've received explains that the term ordinarily resident is a commonly used and well understood legal concept. The term is intended to be flexible to cover a wide range of circumstances. In England and Wales, a coroner's investigation will take place where the death was violent or unnatural, the cause of death was unknown, or the deceased died in state detention. The inquest will mainly determine how, where and when someone died. Coroners will rarely make wider recommendations, but can do so through a Prevention of Future Deaths report. The system is significantly different to the Scottish system of death investigations. In Scotland, fatal accident inquiries aim to establish what happened and to prevent future deaths from happening in similar circumstances. Fatal accident inquiries take place in limited circumstances at the discretion of the Lord Advocate, where a death was sudden, suspicious, unexplained, or gives rise to a serious public concern, and she considered it as vital in the public interest to do so. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service has a role in investigating a wide range of suspicious deaths. However, only a small proportion of these are deemed to require the level of public investigation delivered by a fatal accident inquiry. Now, the Scottish Government has stated that it is not intended to define ordinarily resident in legislation, and highlighted that the inquiries short of an FAI can take place in relation to deaths abroad, such as the instruction of a post-mortem. The petitioner's written submission details his personal experience and raises concerns about the quality of communication to next of kin in such circumstances. The submission also outlines improvements that the Lord Advocate has committed to progress as a result of his engagement with her. So the petitioner has obviously been pursuing the aims and objectives of the petition. So before I ask members to give their consideration to what we might do, can I invite Michael Mara to address the committee?
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you to the committee for the considerations. My constituent, Davy Cornick, as I know him, his petition arises from, as you have noted, Convener, a very deeply personal tragedy, the loss of his son, David, who died in Thailand in 2019. And that's a loss I'm sure that many of us cannot begin to comprehend. And that tragedy has been exacerbated by a legal system that has failed to give Davy and his family the answers they've long sought, as a fatal accident inquiry into David's death never took place. And the crux of the issue does appear to be the definition of ordinarily resident, as the convener set out. And it is on this matter that Mr Cornick's petition is seeking a change from the Scottish Government, but from the Parliament. Since the inquiries into fatal accidents and sudden deaths, etc., Scotland Act 2016 was passed by this Parliament, not one single fatal accident inquiry into the deaths of Scots abroad have taken place. Not one single inquiry. And on the 8th of February 2024, I raised this issue directly with the then First Minister in the Chamber, and he agreed that it was on the basis of this issue of residency. And I quote for the committee's information, convener, it is the issue of residency in that particular case, ordinary residency, that is causing the issue. End quote. Regarding any potential changes to the legislation, Mr. Youssef said he would take a look and speak to the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs on that matter. So my office has followed up with the First Minister's office on 22nd of March and again on 24th of April, but as yet we have received no response. I would perhaps ask if the committee might consider using your good offices to help me in that regard to elicit a response from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, who is obviously still in post following the recent change of First Minister. I was pleased to accompany Mr Cornick to a meeting with the Lord Advocate on the 28th of March. And the Lord Advocate has agreed to contact the Foreign Office regarding formalising a memorandum of understanding to ensure that families are given the correct information if a family member dies abroad. So some progress there can be, I'm glad to say. However, in order for the Lord Advocate to carry out a fatal accident inquiry or to instruct one into a death abroad, the issue of residency will have to be addressed. And I note that the Scottish Government have made the submission that the convener references, in which it is stated that the term ordinarily resident has been established through case law, and the Scottish Government does not intend to define this term in legislation. I'll come back to that if I can, convener, in short order. Regarding this fact that no fatal accident inquiries have taken place into deaths abroad, the Scottish Government submission concedes that this is the case, but also notes, and I quote, that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service are able to conduct inquiries short of an FAI in relation to deaths abroad, such as the instruction of a post-mortem examination, which has allowed further information to be provided to the family and given them reassurance and closure about the circumstances. I would suggest, Camilla, it might be worth the committee exploring the nature of those inquiries that are short of an FAI and the circumstances in which they might be granted. I think that would be very useful to my constituent. So Mr Cornick's family have certainly not had any reassurance of closure about his son's death, very far from it, in fact. So in closing, if I can be so bold, convener, to make some suggestions as to how I think the committee might consider proceeding with the petition. So it is noteworthy that no FAIs have taken place into that deaths of Scots abroad in the last 8 years since that legislation was passed. I think for the committee would, I hope, at least consider or agree with me, that shows that there is a problem in this legislation and that Parliament should be considering what that is. So it does indicate a flaw in the system. And I do appreciate the significant differences between the legal systems in Scotland and England and Wales, and you've, as the convener sent out. I suggest that the committee might seek to ascertain how many deaths abroad of people from England and Wales have been investigated in the same time period from 2016 to present. I think that might offer some ready comparison for whether the laws that we have in place and the procedures we have in place are serving our constituents on a level footing to the rest of the UK. And so finally, regarding the Scottish Government's position that ordinary residency need not be defined in legislation, it might be worth the committee seeking the view of other stakeholders on this matter, such as the legal profession and perhaps Police Scotland, to understand the impact of that decision in their own work in this area. Because if it's not the definition of that term, then certainly the term is used in our legislation, and clearly the ambiguity that is around it is part of the issue that is leading to a lack of justice and transparency and a feeling of resolution for constituents. It's not just Mr. Cornick. I don't believe there will be any members of the Scottish Parliament who do not have constituents who are in a similar situation, looking for answers about how a loved one died abroad. There is an issue of broad justice in this, convener, and if the committee could be implored to continue assisting my constituent in this matter, I think it would be of great assistance to many people in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mara. Are we content in the first instance to embrace the suggestions Mr. Mara has made? And following the conversation and the meeting that Mr. Mara attended with the Lord Advocate, I wonder whether we might consider also just asking the Scottish Government what progress is being made in relation to working with the UK Government to ensure that the differences of the system in England and Wales compared to Scotland are being properly communicated to the next of kin. So just following up on that specific point. Are there any other suggestions that colleagues have got to would want to make? I mean, there were quite a few there. We would just have to think from whom we would obtain information about the instance in England and Wales, but I think we could certainly seek to do that, because I think that would evidence and underpin the contrast in terms of these matters being taken forward.
For an update, I think Mr. Mara said that he did write to First Minister's office and still waiting for an answer, so can we ask First Minister's office as well for the response?
Sorry, Mr. Mara, you wrote to the First Minister?
So I did. I raised this issue with the First Minister in the Chamber. I had a response. We followed up with that letter twice. Obviously, that First Minister has now demitted office. There's a new First Minister. It maybe will be worth, if the committee was so minded, and Mr. Choudhury suggests, trying to ascertain the current First Minister's view of this issue as well.
Yeah.
I would imagine it's in common with the government. But.
Yeah. I suppose we could certainly maybe draw the First Minister's attention to the fact that we have received a petition following up on the issues that were raised with the First Minister at FMQs. On what date? Do you know the date? Do you remember when?
Yes, and so I raised it on the 8th of February 2024, and I wrote on the 22nd of March, and then again on the 24th of April.
Okay, thank you very much. Are we content with the suggestions that have been made? I think we are, and so we thank the petitioner and the petitioner's advocate for the for raising this important matter with us, and we will keep the petition open and proceed on that basis. And that brings us to the end of the public session of this morning's meeting. We'll be next meeting on Wednesday the 29th of May, when we'll be taking evidence from Nicola Sturgeon, MSP, on our inquiry into the A9 duelling project, in addition to the consideration of petitions. And we now move into private session.